intended the great to be great and the little to be little.
The ideas of the 19th century capitalists didn't much encourage the notion of an egalitarian commonwealth. The landlords got rich, those who worked the land were poor, got poorer. And those employed in the mills also remained in that wholesome poverty that meant a hard life in this world, but assured an easy one in the next. Many were spiritually so sustained. An English charwoman, according to legend, wrote a verse for her tombstone. Don't mourn for me, friends, don't weep for me never, for I'm going to do nothing forever and ever. The rich in the last century, by contrast, set more store by the pleasures of this world. There's no doubt, I think, that money caused people to take a better view of this world. And strategy also entered the calculation. If you were affluent, there was that terrible needle through which you had to be threaded before you could emerge in paradise. If you are either rich or a camel, you had better, as a purely practical matter, enjoy life now. In this hour, we want to look at the enjoyments of the rich in the last century and how these were sanctified. By what moral code did the rich live? By what ideas did they defend their affluence? And remembering that ideas, like old soldiers, never die, how do these ideas still affect our lives and our moral tone? I'll be looking at the strong cases, those that dominated the scene. ...1900 was a very good year. Edward Berwind, a Philadelphia coal magnate, was building this chateau at Newport. Andrew Carnegie's steel mills earned him $25 million for himself personally that year. Old-fashioned dollars before income tax. There was no income tax. Back of this wealth were the ideas that justified it. Ideas of which the rich, who were not of bookish lot, were sometimes only vaguely aware. These depended a little on economics, a little on theology, and a great deal on biology. Herbert Spencer put it directly.
Not simply do we see that in the competition among individuals of the same kind, survival of the fittest has from the beginning furthered production of a higher type, but we see that to the unceasing warfare between species is mainly due both growth and organization. Without universal conflict, there would have been no development of the active powers. In this, I am simply carrying out the views of Mr. Darwin in their application to the human race. Thus, I have contended that all being subject to the increasing difficulty of getting a living, there is an average advance under the pressure, since only those who do advance under it eventually survive, and that these must be the select of their generation.
The higher primates here in this Museum of Natural History, in contrast with the slugs and snails or the dinosaurs and the mammoths that never made it to the present, are the products of natural selection. They are the strongest of the species, those best adapted to their environment, and so they survived. And this strength and this capacity for adaptation was taken to explain why some people survived financially, became very rich. It's a peculiarity of the rich that they are much noticed, but very little studied. So it was in the last century as it is now. Men and women of conscience then traveled into the slums, looked into the conditions of the poor. Why were they so poor? Was it lack of ambition? Were they exploited? Was it the natural order of things? All of these explanations had their adherents. And the way of life of the poor was also studied. How were they housed? What did they eat? What were their amusements? And with a delicacy appropriate to the age, how did they breed? The rich, by contrast, were exempt from such attention. They were a proper subject for novels, but not for social study. Poverty was studied. Wealth, though it was exceptional, was natural. It was like the selection of man, the result of natural process. Darwin explained the ascent of man, and social Darwinism explained the ascent of the privileged classes.
Every species of organism, including the human, is always adapting itself, both directly and indirectly, to its conditions of existence.
That was Herbert Spencer. He was an Englishman, philosopher, pioneer sociologist. His life, 1820 to 1903, coincided almost exactly with the age of Victoria. It is to Spencer, and not, as many imagine, to Darwin, that we owe the phrase, the great phrase, the survival of the fittest. The reference was not to survival in the animal kingdom, but to survival in the equally cutthroat world, as Spencer saw it, of economic life. Spencer was a highly prolific, deeply intellectual, exceptionally gloomy writer whose books in the last century were little less than gospel in the United States. In the 40 years following 1860, an estimated 370,000 volumes of Spencer were sold in the United States, and that was before paperbacks, before pornography, and almost before bookstores. And it was no accident. His great ideas fitted the need like a glove. They couldn't, in fact, have been more wonderful. Never had so many been so rich or enjoyed it so much. And Spencer eliminated all guilt. Wealth was the natural result of strength, intelligence, capacity to adapt. The wealthy were the innocent beneficiaries of their own superiority. Many, of course, were poor, but Spencer washed away guilt over this too. The poor were biologically inferior, and they were being selected out. What about charity? It obviously could act to arrest this wholesome weeding out process. It was a problem for Spencer, but in the end, he allowed it. While free meals were bad for those who received them, the giving ennobled those who gave. So charity could be allowed. Spencer, we see, was a stern messiah. Equally stern and very numerous were his American apostles. The most distinguished of these, a generation younger than Spencer, was William Graham Sumner, once described as a man of magnificent baldness. Sumner was a Yale professor, a man of independent and rugged mind, and perhaps the most influential single voice on economic matters in the United States in the last century. It was Sumner's task to join Spencer to Adam Smith and David Ricardo. Sumner was an ardent social Darwinist. He was just as devoted to improving the race as was Herbert Spencer.
The millionaires are a product of natural selection. It is because they are thus selected that wealth, both in their own hands and that entrusted to them, aggregates under their hands. They may fairly be regarded as the naturally selected agents of society for certain work. They get high wages and live in luxury, but the bargain is a good one for society.
It was a sad day when millionaires could no longer send their sons to Yale and be secure in the knowledge that they would receive this kind of instruction. As Jesus came eventually to the temple, Spencer came eventually to America. And the reception in the two cases was broadly the same. By the time of his coming in 1882, he was no longer young. He was 62, and not in the best of health. He was also averse to reporters in the press. The tour, nonetheless, was a triumph. Everywhere he was greeted with enthusiasm by men who could see in their own selection for affluence proof that the race was being improved. Spencer was not himself wholly reassuring. This was an age of exuberant pride in the American achievement, and once or twice he implied that the United States was still at a slightly primitive stage, in Darwinian terms, back maybe with the higher primates. There were also some sour notes here at the Last Supper. This was a great celebration at Delmonico's restaurant, then at the very height of its fame as a watering place of the early American establishment.
We are gathered here tonight, gentlemen, to show the feeling of Americans toward our distinguished guest. The Amazulus, from whom I think a great many things can be learned for the good of the people of the present time, have a maxim. They say the continually stuffed body cannot see secret things. Now, from my personal knowledge of the gentlemen at this table, they are the owners of continually stuffed bodies.
Leaders in business, academic life, politics, and even theology were present. One speaker, Carl Schurz, said that if Spencer's books had been better read in the South,
there never would have been any war for the preservation of slavery.
Henry Ward Beecher was the most famous of American divines, and we'll see him again in a moment. He considered his own salvation completely secure.
You wear an invisible crown on your heart that will carry comfort to death. And I will greet you beyond.
Amen to that. Well said, sir. Well said.
Spencer, for his part, offered the terrible thought, if the workers happened to be listening.
We have had somewhat too much of the gospel of work. It is time to preach the gospel of relaxation.
No one at this happy gathering seems to have worried very much about a small but obvious point. And that is how the social Darwinists would bridge the generation gap. In those years, John D. Rockefeller had formulated the doctrine of natural selection for a Sunday school class in an exceptionally engaging way.
The American beauty rose can be produced in the splendor and fragrance which brings cheer to its beholder only by sacrificing the early buds that grow up around it.
The same process, pro tanto, worked in business. The weak men were lopped off, and this accounted for the splendor, though presumably not the fragrance, of a Rockefeller.
This is not an evil tendency in business, merely the working out of a law of nature and the law of God.
The question, of course, was how this same law of nature and of God would be used to explain the splendor of John D. Rockefeller, Jr., or yet later of Nelson Aldrich Rockefeller and his brother David, the banker. Surely a Rockefeller inheritance, even more than a handout to the poor, would cool the struggle to survive, devastate the morale of the beneficiaries. This was an interesting problem. One that called logically for the abolition of inheritance, something that the affluent did not especially welcome. Rockefeller's adoption of Spencer and Sumner was not unique. It was only more explicit than the others. These ideas were the business ethic of the age. We should look at them now in their practical manifestation. This, above all, was in railroading. Nothing in the last century, and nothing so far in this century, so altered the fortunes of so many people so suddenly as the American or Canadian railroad. The contractors who built it, those whose land would boom in value when it arrived, those who ran it, and those who looted it, could all get rich, sometimes in a week. people who were spared the burdens of wealth were those who laid the rails and ran the trains. Railroading was not a high-paid occupation in the last century. The casualty rates of those who ran the freights, mutilation, death, were only modestly lower than in a first-class war. But the railroads got built, and in the end, they were operated with considerable competence and efficiency. A legion of honest men, we should remind ourselves, bent their efforts to these tasks. Still, Spencer's natural selection worked exceptionally well on behalf of scoundrels.
A railroad allowed, in fact, for an interesting choice between two kinds of larceny, robbery of the customers and robbery of the stockholders. The most spectacular struggle between scoundrels in the last century was between rival practitioners of these two basic arts. It was over the Erie Railroad running on the Jersey side of the Hudson to Buffalo. In those days, the late 1860s, a deplorable and sometimes lethal streak of rust. Cornelius Vanderbilt, who controlled the New York Central across the river, wanted the Erie to ensure his monopoly of service to Buffalo and potentially on to Chicago. His commitment was to robbing the public. Ranged against Vanderbilt was the physically formidable figure, I think some would say the gross figure, of Big Jim Fisk. Jim Fisk died of gunshot wounds at the rather early age of 36, and this was to the general regret of the better class of American citizens, many of whom thought it should have been earlier.
This is the Erie Gang, Vanderbilt's opposition. Jay Gould, an experienced larcenist, Daniel Drew, now aging and somewhat past his best, and Jim Fisk. Their commitment was to robbing the stockholders. Once an individual was in control of a railroad, there was a myriad of devices by which its cash and its other assets could be siphoned off into his own pocket. And these men were masters of every known method. To get control was the thing. In 1867, both Vanderbilt and the Erie Gang wanted the Erie. Vanderbilt wanted his monopoly. Gould, Drew, and Fisk wanted the stockholders' money. And so the inevitable conflict. Vanderbilt had plenty of money from his own New York Central with which to buy the stock. Gould, Drew, and Fisk had something even better. That was temporary possession of the Erie Railroad and of a printing press in the basement of its building. In consequence, they could print more stock than Vanderbilt could ever hope to buy, and yet enough more to keep themselves in control. And this they proceeded to do.
If this printing press don't break down, I'll be damned if I don't give the old hog all he wants of Erie.
Their position, men said, was based firmly on the freedom of the press.
Buy Erie! Buy it! It's the lowest figure you can, but buy it! God in heaven, buy every damn shares that's offered!
The press roared on. Vanderbilt bought, but the press triumphed. Vanderbilt retreated to the courts. Here he had an advantage. He was in personal possession of George Gardner Barnard of the New York Supreme Court. Barnard was one of the best jurists that money could buy, and Vanderbilt had him bought. Barnard enjoined the operations of the Erie men and threatened them with jail. They picked up the books of the railroad, not forgetting his cash, and fled across the river to Jersey City. Jim Fisk, a sensitive man, also took his mistress, a less than virginal young woman named Josie Mansfield. There was a thought that Vanderbilt's men might try to kidnap these refugees back across the Hudson. So a bodyguard was recruited from the railway yards, a flag was hung outside, and the new headquarters in the Taylor's Hotel was renamed Fort Taylor. From this redoubt, they then counterattacked. They now bought Judge Bernard away from Vanderbilt, a very sound step, and they even named a locomotive for him. And they also bought Tammany boss William Tweed and made a director of him. And they also bought the New York State Legislature and had all that stock that they had printed made legal. Vanderbilt was defeated. Fisk and his fellow generals now moved back into New York and into the Opera House.
Jim Fisk, he loved both women and wine, though his heart it was good, I am sure. Though he lived like a prince in his palace so fine, he never went back on the poor. If a man was in trouble, Fisk helped him along. Oh, he tried to do right, though he may have done wrong. Though he lived like a prince in his palace so fine, yet he never went back on the poor.
Fisk's prospects seemed exceptional, until one day he was shot dead by Edward Stokes, a rival for the love of Josie Mansfield. Although poor girl, it seems that she was more than willing to be nice to both. His body was borne back to his hometown, Brattleboro, Vermont, where it received a hero's welcome. And there his tomb, not more beautiful than Jim, still stands. One night in the 1860s, an Erie passenger train out of Buffalo lost four cars over a curve and didn't at first miss them at all. They burned up along with numerous of their occupants. In these years, the personal capital, the wealth, of the Erie gang increased by an estimated $65 million. A single new locomotive, station, or item of rolling stock had been added to the line itself. There was also a highly articulate complaint from the stockholders, many of them English, who never got paid. This sort of thing, plus the fact that the men who worked on the railroad often didn't get paid either, gave the Erie gang a bad name. And it was greatly deserved. The men who did in their customers, as distinct from their investors, had on the whole a much better reputation. Vanderbilt, Rockefeller, Carnegie, Morgan, Guggenheim, Mellon, they all made their fortunes producing cheap, suppressing competition, and selling dear. And as a matter of public relations, this was a far, far better strategy than that of the Erie gang. All of these men acquired the greatest respectability. All except Carnegie founded dynasties of the highest repute. All of them were spoken of reverently as God-fearing men. This involvement of capitalist predation with God in the last century is something that's worth a special word. God, it has often been said, loves the poor, and that is the reason he made so many of them. And that was one reason why scenes such as this were viewed with equanimity in the last century, as unhappily they are now. There was also the Ricardian thought that poverty was inevitable and that action to help the poor would merely result in more breeding, more poverty. And as just mentioned, by natural selection, the poor were being weeded out anyway. So given time, the race would be improved. The undeserving poor would be gone. To believe in natural selection as a remedy for poverty was economical, convenient, and great for one's conscience. Unfortunately, it involved a disagreeable conflict with Christianity. It derived from Darwin, and man was not up from the apes. He and the earth had been created in 6 days. The Bible said so. The conflict was taken up here at the Plymouth Church in Brooklyn, then in a very fashionable neighborhood. The pastor was Henry Ward Beecher, whom we saw with Spencer. In the 60s and the 70s, the rich, the would-be rich, and the merely ambitious flocked to hear Beecher, and Henry Adams guessed that no one had preached with such influence since St. Paul. In 1866, he had written to Spencer,
"The peculiar condition of American society has made your writings far more faithful and quickening here than in Europe."
Beecher, you will see, thought Spencer's views could be reconciled with religion. This he did by making a distinction between religion and theology. Theology was evolutionary. It could accommodate to change. Religion, by contrast, did not change. It was permanent and enduring. The new idea of natural selection belonged to theology, and for that reason, it could be accepted. The Bible, by contrast, was religion, and that had to be taken literally. I've never understood this distinction, and I'm fairly sure that Beecher's congregation didn't understand it either. But it did allow them to believe that they had been naturally selected, that they were naturally superior, and they could believe this without being involved in heresy. So they could enjoy their good fortune without too much anxiety. Beecher had more good news for his people. God loves sinners, and he especially loved the redeemed sinner. So by implication, you could go out of an occasional evening and make God happy. Then repentance would take care of everything. Beecher himself set an example. Perhaps wanting to provide another soul for redemption, he rejoiced the wives of some of his leading parishioners by going to bed with them. Eventually, one of these, Elizabeth Tilton, was overwhelmed by the unfortunate thought that this might be wicked. So she confessed to her husband, who then sued Beecher, and the result was a truly wonderful trial. The jury could not agree as to Beecher's guilt. I think it's fair to say that no one who has since examined the evidence has had any similar doubts. I'm dealing, as I said earlier, with the strong lights and the deep shadows. Many people thought the social Darwinism of Sumner and Spencer was very, very cruel, and Beecher's reconciliation of it with Christianity a fraud. And from the West, as the century ended, there came a voice especially rich in skepticism, even ridicule.
The discipline of savage life has been by far the most protracted in all the life history of the race, so that by heredity, human nature still is and must indefinitely continue to be savage human nature.
Spencer and Sumner held that the millionaires were selected by a savage, barbarian world. Maybe they were only the most successful of the barbarians.
That was the thesis of the man we now meet.
The preeminent critic of the manners and morals of the great American capitalist grew up on this Minnesota farm. Thorstein Veblen was born in 1857 and died in 1929. In the history of economics, sociology, and social science, he is unique. There has been no one, absolutely no one, who was even remotely like him.
The legend has always been of a poor Norwegian farm boy who was driven by a burning sense of injustice. Bevlin's father was indeed a poor immigrant from Norway, but he was a hard-working, intelligent man, and by the time his son was reaching maturity, he was a man of modest wealth. He owned 290 acres of the best land to be found outdoors. And not 100 working farmers, I would judge, back in Norway could have been as affluent as he was. Those who have to make it the hard way have often resented the rich. Why should so few have so much? What justifies their higher income and station? This kind of attack, the rich can always stand. It can be said that it proceeds from envy, and in the end, it affirms their superiority. The Veblen weapon was far more refined. It was ridicule presented as the most somber and careful science. All primitive tribes had their festivals and rituals and orgies, and some of them were exceptionally depraved. And likewise the rich. Their social observances and rituals might be different from those of the savages, differences different in form and detail, but their purpose was the same: self-advertisement, exhibitionism. And for every exhibitionist mannerism or enjoyment of the rich, Veblen came up with some deplorable barbarian counterpart. The Vanderbilts bound up their women in corsets, thus proving that they were purely objects of enjoyment and display. And the Papuan chief carved up the faces and the breasts of his wives to precisely the same end. Veblen could do wonders even with a walking stick.
The walking stick serves the purpose of an advertisement that the bearer's hands are employed otherwise than in useful effort, and it therefore has utility as an evidence of leisure. But it is also a weapon, and it meets a felt need of barbarian man on that ground. The handling of so tangible and primitive a means of offense is very comforting to anyone who is gifted with even a moderate share of ferocity.
Veblen was educated here at Carleton College, only a few miles from the farm. He went on briefly to Johns Hopkins and then to Yale, where, of all things, he was a favored student of William Graham Sumner. Veblen's first and greatest book, The Theory of the Leisure Class, is a study of how the rich seek self-distinction from the use of their riches, their wealth. It's from this book that the great phrases, conspicuous consumption, conspicuous leisure, the predatory culture, pecuniary emulation, phrases that we still hear, come down to us. As a critique of manners, the book had a profound effect on manners. Never again would ostentatious expenditure, be so enjoyable. Let the house be too vast, the party too lavish, the women too garish, the diamonds too glittering, and you could count on some killjoy coming along to cite Veblen. Conspicuous consumption, the Papuans again. The book could not have been better timed, because just as The Theory of the Leisure Class was being published, the classic center of conspicuous consumption in the United States was rising, and this was at Newport, Rhode Island.
last saw these houses one pleasant autumn day in 1961. Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru was visiting President Kennedy, who was staying here in Newport. The president brought him along here on the waterfront in the Honey Fitz, the presidential yacht. "I wanted you to see, Prime Minister," the president said, "how the average American lives." He could have said that these houses were the supreme example of Thorstein Veblen's conspicuous consumption. They belonged to an age when a man's worth was measured in simple, straightforward fashion by his money. When artists and poets and politicians, scientists and sociologists did not dream of disputing the rich man's claim to eminence, and when Hollywood had not been heard from, and when television personalities were not even a dream. But wealth, if it were to distinguish a man, had to be known. He couldn't walk around brandishing $1,000 bills or a statement of his net worth, although it must be said that some tried. So these houses were not places of habitation, recreation, procreation. They proclaimed, they advertised the wealth and therefore the worth of the inmates. In the economic and social history of the last century, one name recurs in our hearing again and again, and that's Vanderbilt. And there's good reason. The Commodore was greatly distinguished for the way he acquired money. He was a builder, and that shouldn't be forgotten. He also robbed the public as distinct from the stockholder, and we've seen that's much better for a man's reputation. He also did this with a forthright candor. He was an honest monopolist, and no family consumed so conspicuously. The most spectacular of the Vanderbilt creations was here at Newport, the Breakers. It cost $3 million. The Vanderbilts are also immortalized by Vanderbilt University, although that cost only $500,000, later raised to $1 million. A vast army of servants was needed to run these establishments. These were trained in disciplined obedience and obeisance, and in the other manners fitting to a subordinate. And this too affirmed the superior station of the owners. As Veblen also observed in a notable passage,
"It is a serious grievance if a gentleman's butler or footman performs his duties about his master's table or carriage in such an unformed style as to suggest that his habitual occupation may be plowing or sheep herding."
The servants, more than incidentally, were also what brought this elegance to an end. At the earliest possible moment, they got other jobs. We can lay it down as a rule that no one spends his life affirming the superiority of others if he has any alternative. Everyone thought the good and faithful butler loved his master until the day when he farted loudly while serving dinner and next day departed. The very first step toward the classless society is always the disappearance of the servant class. The single most enduring feature of wealth is the problem that arises in enjoying it. The poor suppose that the sensuous enjoyments of the rich lie in food, alcohol, and expensive and varied fornication. For the Vanderbilts, food was prepared by a great master chef whom we still see at work. Monsieur Dumont is a lucky survivor. He was booked for an ocean passage by an earlier employer, Mrs. Henry Clay Frick, and prevented from going by her twisted ankle. The ship was the Titanic. Monsieur Dumont's food is excellent, but there are physical limits to the amounts, even of this, that can be ingested. And there are similar, although more elastic, limits to the enjoyment of alcohol and sex. And the consequences of these enjoyments, vast bulk, chronic intoxication, locomotor ataxia, eventually became unfashionable. In fact, the primary enjoyment of wealth, as both Adam Smith and Veblen argued, was not in its consumption, but in its display. How best recruit people for the display? At the turn of the century, this greatly taxed the imagination of the affluent. Mrs. Harry Lair and Mrs. Stuyvesant Fish, rejecting people, once gave a dinner for 100 of the very best Newport dogs. Formal dress was required for the dogs. Fricassee of bones and liver was the main menu item. With much difficulty, the dinner was restaged for this program. The difficulty proceeded from the fact that the manners of dogs have greatly deteriorated. At other dinners, cigarettes were rolled in $100 bills. Oysters were laced with black pearls. And blocks of ice were provided, complete with polar bears. And napkins enfolded very nice diamond bracelets. All of these efforts succeeded, and all of them brought brief notoriety. There was something else that was agreeable for the affluent in this age, which I should mention. They were secure, unfrightened. They did not feel threatened by the poor. That was because most of the poor were themselves recently from Europe. They compared their position not with the people here at the Newport Casino, not with Mrs. Stuyvesant Fish, and not even with her dogs, but with the worst poverty they had escaped. They, too, were part of the American good fortune. Making sure that the denizens of Newport were publicized to the enjoyment of all, the indispensable resident was James Gordon Bennett. Bennett owned the New York Herald. Next only to consuming in a suitably conspicuous way, the greatest pleasure of the rich was in reading about themselves and, of course, imagining that others were reading about them too. This occupation is something that's still greatly enjoyed by the affluent. We speak of a shy millionaire. It's because they're so rare. Bennett's Herald had plenty of room for the activities and depravities of the Newport rich. It didn't go in heavily for public affairs. It once said, "We care nothing for the election of any candidate from president down to constable." Not only did James Gordon Bennett Jr. report on the American rich, he made this into a multinational enterprise. The Herald was recreated in London and also in Paris, and his Paris creation survives, though in a somewhat subdued form, to this day. When the rich in Newport showed signs of being dull, Bennett sent Stanley into Africa to find Livingston, and he sent another expedition into the Arctic to find the North Pole. In his own way, he also set in motion a very different type of explorer. Persons in search not of new lands, but old respectability. The richest of these hunting grounds was the French Riviera. Bennett himself had a villa at Cap Ferrat, and his Paris Herald recorded the movement of American wealth into this new society. The first item in the social column brought familiar news of the Vanderbilts, as one might expect. As you may have seen, Jay Gould was also in the news. The Riviera was the hunting ground because affluence had its own class structure. Social position that was derived from recent wealth was far inferior to that which came from ancient ownership of land. Wealth that derived from industrial or mercantile achievement was far inferior to possessions that in more ancient times had their origins in the more elegant and tasteful processes of military predation, appropriation, piracy, or conquest. In 1891, the first guidebook to this society, specifically for aspiring Americans, was published. It was called Monte Carlo and How to Do It.
In Monte Carlo, it's not unpleasant to find oneself rubbing elbows with an English cabinet minister, to stand by and stake on the luck of a Russian prince, or to be able to let one's friends know what the Prince of Wales wore in the way of tweeds, or the exact cut of the corsage of the notorious Marquis.
The Riviera was preeminently the resort of the European aristocracy, real and contrived. And this was the source of its more important function. Daughters of the American rich could be traded here for the esteem that goes with older landed wealth or title, or sometimes just the title. At one stroke, the new wealth in this fashion achieved the old respectability. And the respectable got the money, which was something that they could usually use. So natural was this bargain that in the end, scores of them were arranged. And brokers appeared, usually impoverished women of some alleged rank, who then arranged the deals. The resulting flow of dollars would have been a recognizable item in the American balance of payments, if a balance of payments had then been calculated. By 1909, by one estimate, 500 American daughters had sacrificed themselves for the family name, this involving a total cash outflow of some $220 million. The greatest, or nearly the greatest, of the English families were the Churchills. Their palace, Blenheim, was one of the grandest of English houses. The title Marlborough, the most honored in British history. Everything fitted in classical form. The Vanderbilt distinction was from ships and railroads and money. The Marlborough title was from armies, war, and conquest. It was natural, maybe inevitable, that a Duke of Marlborough should marry Consuela Vanderbilt, the descendant of the original robber baron. The Vanderbilt down payment was $2,500,000. And all the Marlborough connection cost the Vanderbilts around $10 million. Soon, no name was more impeccable than Vanderbilt. And Marlborough, as dukes go, was very solvent. The other service to the rich came from the casino here at Monte Carlo. It derived from its superlative efficiency in doing what they most needed, advertising the existence of their wealth.
Monsieur, faites le jeu. Rien ne va plus. Dix, noir fermant.
Transversal simple, carré, cheval et plein.
The sociology of gambling is very little understood. Most people think that men and women gamble to make money. And without doubt, many do. But some also gamble to lose money. And in the last century, this was very important. Men and women of the highest fashion, those whose judgment determined above all an individual's social rank and repute, assembled here of a night. Richly caparisoned, they moved around the tables and through the adjacent salon. Never before or since was there such an audience for the man who wanted to show that he had money to burn. If he was rich, he couldn't lose. If he dropped $1,000 or $50,000, he showed to this audience that to him it meant nothing. And if he won, it was not an irretrievable misfortune.
Monsieur, faites le jeu.
Have the manners and morals of the moneymakers improved? A question that I suppose everyone will ask. As to the manners, there's no doubt. Vanderbilt, Jim Fisk, Jay Gould, showing up here, or even in Texas, would be thought, you know, very coarse. Their avarice would be considered too obvious. Men and women would shudder to hear Vanderbilt tell the public to be damned. In our time, in our day, the most ruthless predator must present himself as a public benefactor. He must speak admiringly of his own single-minded concern for the people. And if he makes money, it is only because that is the nature of the free enterprise system. Regular bathing is obligatory, and no great entrepreneur can chew tobacco. In all of these ways, the manners of modern capitalism have been improved. As to the advance in morality, some will wonder. Investors Overseas Services, IOS, Robert Vesco, C. Arnhold Smith, Polson, Hoffman, the Real Estate Fund of America. Not everyone will believe that these are a quantum step up from Erie. But the 20th century is not the 19th century. The men and enterprises I've just mentioned were in the freewheeling manner of 19th century money making. And I do believe that the truly acquisitive heart beats about the same from one generation to the next. Even the techniques have all been discovered remain pretty much the same. But the institutions, the business environment, does change. The world of old-fashioned capitalism has given way to the organization. And the old-fashioned capitalist was not the modern organization man. Later on in these programs, we will look at the corporation and its organization and the code by which it is run. And any moral judgments, if they must be made, yours or mine, had better be postponed until then.